Good evening. My name is Cynthia Cabu. I'm a neuropsychologist at the Cleveland Clinic, and I serve as well on the advisory board of the Healthcare Businesswomen's Association. Welcome. We've got an official welcome coming from Dr. Dan Feek here soon, representing Case Western Reserve University. I want to tell you that this started with just a simple question and a simple idea. I asked a few people, what would happen, or what do you think about the idea of getting some of the top organizations in the city together and partnering with the HBA to talk about promoting women in science and medicine in Cleveland? What do you think of that idea? Well, this is what people think of that idea, which I think is really pretty incredible. And we're going to be continuing this on an annual basis, and we're going to be looking for ideas and people to help. I want to also emphasize, too, that this is very much a collaborative effort, and that's, I think, more than anything, what is required in this day and age in science as well as medicine. I'm very, very grateful for the support of Case Western Reserve University with the Flora Stone Mather Center for Women, the women faculty of the School of Medicine, the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, the Metro Health System, Biomotive, and my very own and dear Cleveland Clinic Women's Professional Staff Association. We couldn't do this without everybody's involvement. We've got, I think, an exciting program for you, a program that hopefully will generate ideas and lead to positive change. That's the goal, positive change. And right now, I'd like to welcome Professor Dan Feek, who's Vice Provost for Undergraduate Education here at Case Western Reserve University.
Thank you very much, and good evening to everybody. It's my privilege to welcome you here tonight on behalf of Case Western Reserve University and Provost Buzz Bazelak, who wishes he could be here tonight, but he's currently under the weather, and he asked me to substitute him for him tonight. Welcome. We appreciate that you're here on our campus tonight. Tonight's program, with multiple community partners, aimed at thinking about gender bias and how it affects the scientific and medical workplace, is personally important to me. I've been on the steering committee of the NSF-funded Advanced Institutional Transformation Grant at Case Western Reserve University, which is intended to seek equity for women faculty in the STEM fields. Our university, we were very proud to be the first private research university to obtain this grant under the leadership of Dr. Lynn Singer, who you'll be hearing from later, and Dr. Diana Bilamoria, who also is on the program tonight. I'd like to especially welcome members of the Healthcare Businesswomen's Association, one of our major sponsors of tonight's event. I know that tackling gender bias will make us a stronger university, a stronger region, and a stronger nation. And especially want to thank Dr. Cynthia Cabu from the Cleveland Clinic, who organized tonight's program, and we'll be introducing our distinguished speakers and panelists. We are very proud that Case Western Reserve University can host such an important meeting as tonight's. Thank you, and have a great evening.
Well, it is my distinct privilege to introduce Dr. Diana Bilamoria. She is the Key Bank Professor and Chair and Professor of Organizational Behavior at the Weatherhead School of Management, Case Western Reserve University. She received her PhD in business from the University of Michigan, which we don't hold against her. And her research is really focuses on gender and diversity in governance and leadership and organizational transformation. Her studies have helped corporate, educational, and non-profit organizations reinvent themselves and establish practices that attract and retain a high-performance, diverse workforce. More personally, what I really treasure about Diana is her unflappable calm. She exudes this calm presence that belies a very steely determination. And it's both of those qualities, I think, that have contributed to her success and to her amazing influence throughout women in science. So thank you very much.
I just wanted to say a word of thanks, certainly to Cindy Kubu and to the HBA, and glad to be here with you to share a little bit about the research and the evidence that we have behind gender bias in science and medicine. So I want to start with the question, why so few and why so slow? And you can see here a picture of the Solvay conference. This is Marie Curie. I might editorialize, she's looking a little fed up there. Take a look at 100 years later. And there are two women in that picture. So 100 years has resulted in doubling the number of women. Many, many questions abound. Why is this so slow, and why are these factors so complex? And it's because of the interplay between a number of different aspects that are societal, occupational, organizational, interpersonal, relational, and individual. And I want to share a little bit about what those factors are and what do they tell us overall. I'll reference particularly a phenomenon called second generation gender bias. First generation bias is what we would refer to as deliberate, overt, and discrimination. We've all had examples of this. But second generation bias is unconscious, subtle, invisible, and inadvertent. And it's been described as the powerful yet invisible barriers to women's advancement that arise from cultural beliefs about gender, as well as the workplace structures, practices, and patterns of interaction that inadvertently favor men. I want to share some examples of that with you today, and then reach a consensus about what the overall impact of this has been. So I'm going to share with you the website in 2002 of Berkeley Engineering. Their motto is educating leaders, creating knowledge, serving society. It's probably a little difficult to read, but let's go through what they show us. So we're going to start with the faces of Berkeley Engineering. We're going to see students, faculty, and alums. Under students, we have Julia, who studies the martial art of Wushu. Kibibi, who is a table tennis champion. And we have Anthony, who's a Lego robot creator. Under faculty, we have Werner, who wrote the book on impact, Ali, who's a circuit maven, and Jennifer, who's an accomplished viola player. And alums, we have Oren, who is a Pixar wizard, we have Julia, who is a volunteer holic, and we have Floyd, who is a chip guru. What we notice in this is that gender bias is very subtle, it's implicit, and sometimes it's invisible. So women in this website are not given the superlative adjectives, guru, wizard, creator, and so on. And they're described only for their non-work or non-technical, non-scientific accomplishments and achievements. Here's a study that was done about 5 years ago or so. And they looked at the likelihood of hiring a lab manager. And they looked at competence attributions and hireability for a lab manager position. So 127 science faculty from research-intensive universities rated the application materials of a student who was randomly assigned either male, John, or female, Jennifer, name, for a lab manager position. Let's take a look at the results of that. So this is both men and women who are faculty members who are filling out this survey about how much they would, how likely they were to hire them, how competent do they think they are, what kind of mentoring would they give them, and what salary they would give them. So as you can see, male is the dark black and female is a light gray. So, and these are all significant differences. So women are rated as being less competent, less hireable, would receive less mentoring from themselves, from the faculty who are filling this out, and about a $4,000 less salary. And the only difference on the resumes of these two characters, characterizations, is the name. So everything else on the resume is identical. So we have to wonder, why is it that when hiring a lab manager, science faculty would pay $4,000 more for a male called John than a female called Jennifer? This is a study that was done a few years ago about applicant packages for psychology professors. Again, they were identical resumes. The only difference is the name, Brian versus Karen. When evaluating these identical application packages, male and female psychology professors preferred 2-to-1 to hire Brian over Karen as an assistant professor. They also did a second level of analysis looking at a little bit higher or more experienced record. So when evaluating a more experienced record at the point of promotion to tenure, not just hiring of assistant professors, but promotion to tenure, reservations were expressed 4 times more often when the name was female. This replicates a series of other findings very commonly known in the field as the Goldberg paradigm, where everything is kept constant except one variable, which is changed to reflect how people would respond to that variable. Another study that I want to just highlight is a study that was done on orchestras. And this orchestra study found that by simply making the audition blind, that is putting a curtain between those evaluating the performance for hire and the person playing the instrument for the orchestra, simply putting that curtain or making the audition blind increased the chances for women to be selected for that orchestra. I thought I'd make a similar kind of comparison with authorships in the academic world, because much of our science is driven by the publications that go through the peer review process. So this is the example of behavioral ecology, which is a particular subject matter that is common, I think, to many of us here in this room. After behavioral ecology instituted a double-blind review process in 2000, the proportion of female first authors increased significantly during the 5 years immediately after that, 2002 to 2007, as compared with the 5 years before that, 1995 to 2000. And no such shifts happened over the same time period for competing journals such as behavioral ecology and sociobiology, with similar impact factors and similar subject matter, or 4 out of 5 other these ecology and evolutionary biology journals. Again, it's a very strong statement about the way by which implicit gender bias operates in the minds of the reviewers or the editors to whom the authorship is not blind. Here's an interesting study that was done about recommendation letters for medical school applicants, medical school faculty applicants. So letters of recommendation for male successful medical school faculty applicants were longer, had more references to their CV, their publications, patients, and colleagues. Letters for successful women faculty medical school applicants were shorter, had more references to personal life, and they carried more hedges, what they called doubt raisers, qualifiers, and faint praise. And these were, as you can see, significant as well. So women is blue, men is orange. And both doubt raises and minimal assurances were significantly higher for women. I'll just share a couple more of these studies and then we'll pull it together. This is the content of psychology faculty recommendation letters. So I know we all write recommendation letters. Let's take a look at those that were really studied to see what do they tell us. So this is letters of recommendation for female psychology faculty applicants written by both male and female recommenders as compared with the males in the same department. The recommendation letters for males in the same department contained significantly more words that were communal, affectionate, helpful, kind, sympathetic, sensitive, nurturing, agreeable, caring. Significantly less words that were agentic, assertive, confident, aggressive, ambitious, dominant, forceful, intellectual. Significantly more words that were socio-communal, that is related to family relationships. And significantly more words that were related to the physical body. Arms, breast, eyes, face, hips, hair, muscle, nails, pregnancy, and mouth. I know you see that this is absurd too. This is absurd, but this is what these studies have found. And so I urge you to worry about the letters of recommendation that you write and to make sure that the stereotypes of women as communal and socio-communal, less agentic, are, you know, weighed carefully, considered through, even as you write your recommendation letters. Here's another study. This was done by our colleague Shelley Correll and others about parenthood. Again, a very disturbing set of findings. Again, the same paradigm, identical applications, only varying certain variables. When evaluating identical applications in an experimental study, mothers were less likely to be recommended for hire, promotion, management, and were offered lower starting salaries than non-mothers. So again, no difference in the application, just the fact that they're mothers penalizes them. Evaluators rated mothers as less competent and less committed to paid work than non-mothers, and fathers were seen as more committed to paid work and were offered higher starting salaries than non-fathers. A similar workplace study that was done, prospective employers called mothers back about half as often as non-mothers, and fathers were not so disadvantaged in the hiring process. So a real set of schemas, unconscious and implicit biases that sometimes can serve as shortcuts, as cognitive heuristics for us, but which can often result in inadvertent favoring of one group over another. I'm going to conclude with just two more studies. I'm going to move beyond specific science and medicine. This is Google Ads. You know, when you go to a website and then you see some ads, you don't know how they appear, but they do. All right. So this is a 2015 study of Google Ads conducted by computer scientists at Carnegie Mellon. Researchers created 1,000 simulated users, half designated male, half designated women, female. Had them visit 100 top employment sites. They then reviewed the ads that were shown to the simulated users. Here's what they found. The site most strongly associated with the male profiles was a career coaching service for executive positions paying more than $200,000. By comparison, the ads most associated with female profiles were for a generic job posting service and an auto dealer. Significantly fewer women than men were shown online ads promising them help getting jobs paying more than $200,000. Male users were shown high-paying jobs about 1,800 times compared to female users who saw those ads about 300 times. That's a 6 times difference, isn't it? The researchers tried to figure out how is this possible, but they were unable to pin down who or what, because this was a computerized program that still carried this tremendous bias simply on the basis of whether the user was designated a female or a male. A last example, stars in Hollywood. What do you think is the average age when a male actor reaches his earnings peak? 25. All right, a big range. Answer 51. How about the average age when a female actor reaches her earnings peak? You got it. 34. But this was not the end of it. Male earnings stay stable beyond earnings peak. Female earnings decline precipitously beyond earnings peak. So she has a longer time frame in her career where she gets paid less. And he has a longer, has a shorter time frame, but he gets paid much more. What does this all mean for us folks? Clearly the evidence shows that gender bias arises from a complex interplay. This is societal, this is organizational, it's certainly occupational as well, particularly in occupations such as science and engineering, medicine, and so on. Gender bias in science and medicine is longstanding, it's pervasive, and it's systematic. Simplistic or piecemeal solutions will not eradicate systematic gender bias. We simply know that. It's just not going to happen. What is needed instead is that institutions implement simultaneous, multi-level, and multifaceted change initiatives that systematically transform structures, cultures, and work practices in order to engender improved diversity, equity, and inclusion outcomes. The example of our NSF Advance projects, or the examples of much of the work that is being done by the institutions that are supporting today's event, are examples of the kind of systematic efforts that are needed in order to bring about gender equity change to offset these complex factors that create gender bias. And when this happens, when gender bias is transformed, the workplace improves, not just for women, but it improves for men and for everyone in the workplace as well. Thank you very much, everyone.
You all are going to get tired of my face. Unfortunately, Laura Butler, the past president of the Ohio chapter of Healthcare Business Women's Association, was unable to come because of snow. Imagine that. And so I am moderating in her place, which means, you know, panelists be kind. And I'll go down to the end there by Lynn when I'm done here. A couple things. I'm going to introduce our panelists. But I guess I wanted to just start a little bit reflecting. When I discovered maybe 2 hours ago that I was going to be moderating, I was reminded of a talk I attended here with Catherine Lucy. And she spoke to the Women Faculty School of Medicine. She talked about wicked problems. And wicked problems are those in which you just can't do this linear hierarchical kind of problem-solving mode. Like, you know, how do you solve a problem in geometry? It's not rule-bound. It's something that requires much more of a multiple perspectives, people attacking things at different levels. And she spoke about translational and transactional leadership. And one of the things she said about transformational leaders, and she quotes Lightwood here, it's a relationship of mutual stimulation and elevation that converts followers into leaders and may convert leaders into moral agents. And I like that idea of moral agents because it's something we don't really think about in terms of science and medicine. And I think that we're really privileged today because I think everybody on this panel is a moral agent. There's somebody that wants to do something right for the right reasons or to do the right thing, as Joe Hahn, the former chief of staff, would always say at the Cleveland Clinic. And so with that, nod here to our distinguished panelists, I'm going to just briefly introduce them and then we'll start a discussion. We have Dr. Akram Boutros here, who is the president and chief executive officer of the Metro Health System, one of the largest and most comprehensive health systems in Northeast Ohio. He's an internist with a 20-year record of successful hospital leadership at academic medical centers, community hospitals, and specialty hospitals. The thing you may not know, but you will quickly learn if you haven't met him already, is that he is one of the most genuinely warm and kind persons you can meet with a strong commitment to diversity. Next to him, we have Dr. Kara Tseng, who's just a little bit impressive. She is the founding chair of the Genomic Medicine Institute and founding director of the Institute's clinical component, the Center for Personalized Genetic Healthcare at the Cleveland Clinic, as well as a professor and vice chairman of the Department of Genetics and Genome Sciences at Case Western Reserve University School of Medicine. She's the author of only a gazillion articles and published manuscripts, and the holder of several million dollars worth of lifetime grants from various funding agencies. What you may not know is that she's an outstanding mentor. Two of my trainees are working under, she's mentoring two of my trainees now, and it's hard to give up your children, but if you have to, she's the best person to do it with. And I absolutely love her refreshing candor, and I think you will appreciate it as well. Next to her, we have Julie Woda, who I'm quite excited to meet. She's the only one that I didn't know and pulled in through my connections here. But she's got and I think the fact that I don't know her speaks to the fact that we need to. She has over 23 years of biological research and drug development experience in the biotech sphere. And I think this speaks to one of the reasons why we wanted to host this event, is let's get the women in industry and the biotech industry talking with the women in science and medicine and the women in healthcare and business, so we can all promote each other. From my understanding, she has a number of very unique perspectives, and I'm going to make her speak out if she doesn't. Then we have Dr. Evelyn Gates. She is an alum of Case Western Reserve University with getting a PhD in theoretical physics. I still have nightmares about physics, I'm sorry. That and calculus. She is the executive director and CEO of the Cleveland Museum of Natural History and has a very strong and personal commitment in addressing the underrepresentation of women and minorities in the physical sciences, and she's published in this area as well. I think that I am most excited about her being on the panel because it's a very bold vision in terms of making science accessible to everybody, as well as showing the various ways in which you can have an amazing career in science and medicine in ways that I certainly had never considered before. And then finally, we have Dr. Lynn Singer, who is one of those people that I just connected with immediately when I met her, and I consider her a friend. She serves as the Case Western Reserve University's Deputy Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs. She has focused university efforts on developing programs that advance women and underrepresented minority faculty in science and engineering. She was the principal investigator of an NSF Advanced Institutional Transformation Award that led to increases in the number of women in the STEM fields overall and in senior leadership positions. Her passion is quite strong in terms of advocating for women and minorities in the STEM fields. She is also a psychologist that has an incredible career with a number of publications as well. And I appreciate most her curious, approachable, and highly committed passion to women in science and medicine. So what we're going to do is I'm going to shift over to the couch, and we're going to open up a panel discussion. And while we're chatting, I want you to pay attention, but most of you can multitask too and think of questions for our distinguished panelists, okay?
Well, he's talking, who thinks I shouldn't be on this couch? They're so much smarter than me. I'm feel really terrible. So please forgive me. I don't know if I'm going to do as well.
Who thinks we need
good. Now, just as an aside, they don't make these things for women with dresses, right? And where do you tuck it?
That's true.
But that's just an aside. All right. I am filling in for Laura, and but she assured me that she had given you an idea of some of these questions beforehand. What I want you to do is, I've introduced you already, but I want you to share, and I guess we'll start with you since you already started the discussion. And this, she may not have told you this question, but what part of your resume are you most proud of? What part of your resume fills you with the most pride? Or what may be hidden in those lines in between all the accomplishments and accolades?
I think probably, honestly, it's a very hard question. I'm not sure if most of my resume is about accomplishments. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at them, there are lots of numbers, and because people like to see that. But I would say to you, the part that's hidden in my resume is the amount of teamwork that went into creating great results. The other part that you would have to look hard for is the human aspect of managing a health system or a hospital, because I see that as a much more important role than the numbers and the operational metrics and all of that. So you have to actually be perceptive to look for it. Mm-hmm. But let me just say this to you. About a few years ago, I stopped working on my resume and started working on my eulogy.
There you go. But that's it. Let's hope you don't have to use it for a while.
I don't think anybody's going to care what my resume says. I think people are going to care about who I am. And so I'm starting to focus on what will people say about me and the impact I had.
Yes.
So that's the way I think about it. I think about, well, I'm not going to be there. I'd like them to say nice stuff in my eulogy, because mm-hmm. no one is going to read my resume.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Good point. So it's really that emotional intelligence piece and connecting with people. Fantastic. Karis.
Well, not so hidden my resume, because I listed out is I am a mentor. And I've listed my mentees, and importantly, I proudly list the awards that they have won. So my eulogy would be, she was a great mentor.
Exactly.
The second thing, so the three things. So the second thing I'm very proud of is that I give a good wine and genomics talk. And the third thing is, and it's very funny, it's a quote by Reba McEntire, and you know, I hardly knew her, and she's a singer. And I'm an opera fan, so it's not that type of singer. And she said, to be successful in life, you got to have a wishbone, a backbone, and a funny bone. So, right? So vision, strength of spirit, and a good sense of humor.
That's lovely. Thank you. Julie.
Okay, so I'm not working on my eulogy yet. And I was thinking about this. So, I mean, I think there's two parts I'm most proud of. One is that I've had research associates and interns work with me, and I'm not as distinguished as people here. I haven't had as quite a long career, but I've been really proud of being able to help them understand. A lot of times they don't have advanced degrees. Maybe they came out of college in biology and they're trying to learn, and really spending a lot of time helping them understand science and getting to the point where they themselves either apply for a program or get to the point. I think one of the things I liked the most was I had a research associate work with me, and it got to the point where I actually felt like I could leave the job because he could do so much of what I was doing that I didn't even feel like he really needed as much of my assistance anymore, and I was able to do something else. And it was really great. I love that. I also am proud of working to help find therapeutics. I mean, I went into science because I wanted to do that, and well, I haven't had the chance to work on something that's gone all the way into through clinical trials and an approved medication. But that's what I want to do, and I love the fact that I get to at least try to contribute to it. And even if something doesn't work, at least no one else has to waste their time trying that, and we can move on to something else. So I think that's probably the second most thing I'm proud of.
Fantastic. Thank you.
So I'm going to flip things around a little bit and go full nerd on everyone. I don't know what I would be most proud of, but when I look at my resume, what really speaks out to me are a couple of the things that I worked on, and the fact that I've had this incredibly, lucky beyond all measure to work in a field where I could dive into a problem in science and just get completely, totally lost in what I was doing. And you time stops, and you really get in that zone. And so what I'm trying to do right now, I guess, is what I would probably be proud of, which is give more people and a more diverse group of people the opportunity to get into that zone. It's, science is so much more fascinating and compelling and exciting. And that's the one thing I remember is just really how lucky I've been.
Fantastic, thank you.
So after all that, I'd say two things. I'd say one, having had the opportunity to meet so many people like Diana, so many people in this room actually, that I've been able to work with, and we've been able to do things together. So that's, to me, one of the joys of being an administrator. There are a lot of frustrations, but one of the joys is that you can kind of pull people together, and I think that's terrific. We've done, the Center for Women, we have an LGBT center, we've been doing these NSF grants, we just got an AGAP grant. So that, to me, I think I'm very proud of those things, but it's because of so many wonderful people that are doing these things, and you have the opportunity to kind of help them do it or facilitate it. The other thing I will say, given this group in particular, that I think I was thinking about all of these negotiation and all of the stuff that's going on with gender bias, but I do think a turning point in my career was I had a grant, and it was on drug-using women, and it was not viewed well by the hospital because of the clientele. So I was I had a clinic, and the hospital really did not want the clinic. And I was able, for the first time in my career, which before that I think I felt like, well, here is the circumstance, I'm stuck in this, this is what I have to do. And just said no, and we moved the clinic to Metro, actually with the help of the dean of the medical school, one of the deans of the medical school at the time, and some very, very wonderful people in the pediatrics department who allowed me to transfer the money over there. I was really worried they're not going to let me take the money. But it was the first time I really had the ability to say, I know that's not what I'm going to do. And I think trying to help others see that you do have a lot of power. And as I'm a faculty here, I think a lot of the faculty issues, faculty have so much power in their own careers if they start taking advantage of that. So that was kind of a turning point for me.
So to own your power.
Yeah. And the center was great.
That has been one of the greatest differentiator between women executives and male executives. Male executives will come in and fight for something that is for them, and they have a lot of courage and bravado with it. The one that I've seen most women really ignite at is when they're fighting for someone else. When they have a cause, there is no stopping them. And I've said often after the person came in, I said, okay, yes, 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 yes. I said, why couldn't you do that for you? Why couldn't you do that for, I really appreciate the fact that you're championing somebody else's cause, but you need to do the same thing for you.
I think that's absolutely right. We heard that at the Women Faculty School of Medicine had a speaker last week, yeah. And so many people got up and they can't speak for themselves.
So practice.
And stand up for themselves.
What I'm going to do now is I'm going to shift things, but thank you all for your responses. I think there are a number of important themes that I hope everybody's paying attention to, especially the students, okay? All righty. And I've got a question for all of you, and I guess the question is, given the fact that I think that, and Diana gave us a very eloquent presentation here about how systemic and subtle gender bias is, and maybe just bias in general, but we're talking about gender bias tonight. How do we start to have these conversations in our own organizations? And just to highlight for all of you here, you all were chosen intentionally because you represent different areas within science and medicine and different roles within those organizations. And so from your unique perspective and your institution, how do we start to have these discussions so that we can start to make the changes that are necessary in light of the changing demographics in medicine and science?
Okay. Well, that settle? I thought of a couple of things. I was trying to think. I'd like us to leave here today with some, yes. something concrete to do. I believe in incremental change. I think, you know, often we have multiple things we want to do, but let's take the first one and keep moving up on certain things. So I think what we're doing here today is a very good start, because educating, I don't know about you, but when you become unaware of these things, or you talk yourself into believing that they don't really exist. And then when you see the facts, you're hit in the head with them. And I think, given two groups that I've seen over the last couple of weeks, one that Karen Horwitz arranged, we had a speaker about negotiation, and one that Diana and Susan Freemark have put together with What's Next, clearly seeing that women and male faculty need to have the facts, and they need to see that this is, it's not an opinion, it's a fact. I was very shocked at the science study when it came out. I can't believe it. I can't believe it's something that's so objective in terms of, you know, running a lab and having the experience could come out with such a differential. So being continually surprised, but then it gives you the courage, I think, and the facts so that you can then speak up and say no, that bringing in the person that would have been ignored. Mm-hmm. But getting on those committees so that you can do that is a part of it. Educating ourselves and also getting into those positions where you do have a say and speak up.
Excellent, thank you. Evelyn.
Yeah, so I think some of the biggest challenges is none of us want to think that we're biased. We don't want to think we have any gender biases. And especially if you're younger and just getting into these things, you will take it on yourself and saying, I'm just imagining it, it's not real, it's someone else. So one of the biggest things you can do is talk to your colleagues and students to students, faculty to faculty, and these kinds of discussion do raise awareness. But I think one of the most powerful changes I've seen within the field of physics has come through this advanced program. And I will tell you what's happening. What we're seeing now is faculty are being hired into new junior faculty positions within physics at a level that's commensurate with the available pool. So the number of postdocs translates into junior faculty, which is huge in this field. We're still at a level of 6 to 8% in physics are faculty, full faculty, and at the undergraduate level, we're not doing very good at all. But the neat thing about it was that the way the program changed hiring practices was not to try to change everyone's way of thinking. It was a very practical thing, which is, it seems to make common sense, decide in advance what the criteria are for this person that we're going to hire, what are they going to do, and make sure that everyone agrees, and then make sure that you've got a panel that will pull it back when the conversation veers off. It's completely changed how hiring takes place. So I take from that great encouragement, you can have change, a change is possible. But there's still, you know, too much that's going on in these subtle biases, because I'm looking around at a room of academics, and academics are especially bad at admitting that they could be anything other than cerebral, intellectual, we think only, we don't have any of these emotional things. And I will tell you, we're all raised in a culture that's extremely gendered. I cannot be without gender bias. None of us can. The best thing we can do is sort of try to identify it the best that you can, and then begin to find ways to institute programs that allow you to mitigate that as much as possible.
Thank you.
So I'm coming from a slightly different take. I'm actually at, I've been at private companies and they've been very small companies. So it really changes the dynamic because there isn't institutional programs. They're just an individual hiring someone. And you do have to be very careful on how you bring it up because very small communities where everything's based on recommendations, you can't walk in there and say, most people are not, most people I've met are not the kind of madmen style chauvinists. I mean, everybody thinks they're a good person. If you go in there and say you're being biased, and this is somebody who you have to work with, they're going to be insulted and hurt, and they're not going to hear anything you say. And so, and I wasn't surprised at any of that because I've seen the subtleties. And every single thing that was up there, I've actually seen either personally or, you know. So I, from a practical level, I think you have to stand up for yourself and willing, just have the try to build the confidence in yourself when you're working with very few people. It's easy to say, no, actually, it's me. Maybe I'm not as confident. Maybe I'm not as good. Maybe I didn't get that position or the promotion. Maybe because my work isn't quite as good, even though you may, you know, you have to be able to step back from yourself and say, yeah, I am. I'm going to speak up. With the understanding that when I speak up, I'm bossy. When I'm not, I'm too quiet. And that it does happen. And I just sort of, I've always kind of tried to address it in a jokey manner, in a manner that is not threatening, but yet not let it go. I think not letting it go in a very collegial way is very important. And from a practical point of view, if you're not the hiring person, you're sitting there saying, okay, well, how am I gonna help me? I would love for everyone to get at this high level where they do everything blind, but that's not what's going on right now. How can I get a position and get paid? And I think the other thing is just not being as scared to negotiate. It's still not gonna get you all the way, I can tell you. I've never left a dollar on the table and I still got paid less. But I still got paid more than I would have been paid if I hadn't pushed up until that point. And you just have to say no, you know, and just know in your heart, okay, all the men asked for more. My advice to all the women I know is just ask for more. When they give you a number, don't say yes. Even though you really want the job and you know you do it, just don't say yes.
So it's that theme of, as Beth Mooney would say, relentless incrementalism.
Yes.
Okay, Karis.
So I think I found that, which was touched upon here, that if you do good stuff for both men and women, so it doesn't matter, it will absolutely help women. So I was asked to chair the Women Faculty Mentorship Committee at Ohio State University. And there were men and women. And when we did an as-is assessment is, you know, there's stuff for both men and women. And what's good for all faculty are typically good for women as well. And so here's transparency, the criteria. There was no paternity leave. We brought it on. Well, there's maternity leave as well. And things like that. Negotiation. So let me say one thing. Yeah, no, we're rotten. I'm rotten at negotiation. But you should also know or at least get a feel who your future boss is, because if you're negotiating with a boss like me, it almost says to me that this person doesn't even know how to genotype a real mentor. So make that discrimination. I know it's going to be rare, but it almost says this person is being unreasonable. In fact, this happened yesterday, right? The person was asking, so this is an assistant professor who is walking in with 9 months experience, and I was already giving her something more, and she wanted to work less and was asking for an annualized salary of an associate professor with 5 to 7 years experience. Don't do that, which means that do your homework, so know the facts.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you.
So I guess I would say a couple of things. One is that there are certain things you can do to improve, practical things you can improve hiring processes and the like. I will tell you is that I, being a CEO, everybody pays attention to what you do. Mm-hmm. So we were talking earlier, one of the things is my male executives like to do is this euphemistic marking of their territory, right? So they do it in every now and then. They do it in the executive room as we're sitting down and talking, and I get to say, you got to stop. You're splashing everybody. Okay, so they do it, and I get to say that, and it kind of dispels things. But one of the things I did, I asked every executive, every one of my senior and executive vice presidents, was to take the Harvard University Implicit Association test. So I don't want you to tell me what the results are. I want you to know how you are biased. Okay. So I happen to be gender biased. I happen to be gender biased for women. So if I just looked tonight to see what in my 2.5 years, what's happened is that we've promoted or hired 9 new vice presidents and senior vice presidents who are women and 4 men. I'm clearly gender biased. Now, I will tell you is that I tried very hard not to be gender biased. And so one of the things we've tried to do is to figure out, well, the best way to make sure that we're not gender biased is to make sure that we have enough candidates, qualified candidates. So we actually set up for any management or physician position that 45% of the candidates had to be gender and race diverse. We're at 76%.
Wow.
And that turns out to be very similar to the number of people who are race and gender diverse who are hired. So if you have the right number of folks in front of the, I don't know any manager who hires people not thinking of themselves first. I think I said to you, 2 senior vice presidents just got promoted. The senior vice president walks in and she says, her first response to me is, "You won't regret this. I won't let you down." The guy said to me, "You know, it's about time you figured out how great I am." And my response to him was, "You know, if you think that's why I hired you, that means I can also change my mind, think you're not so great." Yeah. And to the other woman is that I didn't hire you to be nice to you. I hired you to be nice to me. I wanted to know who's gonna make my life easier. That's why you were hired. I wasn't hiring you to be nice to you. So irrespective of what your gender is. So one of the things we need to understand is that when people give you opportunities, they're not giving you opportunities to be nice to you. They're giving you opportunities because you are the best person for the job.
Exactly.
Okay. Nobody's that wants to have that issue.
Fantastic. We've already started to touch a little bit on the second question, which is, what do we do now and moving forward to guard against bias? And I want to ask, you know, you're all leaders in your various organizations. I want you to kind of think back to when you weren't. And, you know, practical advice for those junior or mid-career people as they're negotiating all of this. How do you guard against it? I mean, if you're the CEO, you can say, I want a diverse set of people from which that I'm interviewing so I can check, you know, who's the best for the job, who's going to make my job easier. You know, but if you're not, and, you know, how do you start to make those incremental changes in the daily interactions we all face in our workplaces? You know, what do we do? And so if you could speak on that, and maybe I'll have you start, Evelyn, if that's okay.
Yeah, so there are a couple of things. Depending on where you are in your career, you're treading a fine balance because you really do need to focus on, you know, whether it's medicine, science, whatever you do. I don't think we want to add an extra weight to younger people saying, you've also got to fix this whole system when you can't. You've got to find the time to really be able to do what you need to do. At the same time, you also need to make sure that you have some touch points. So I think, again, being part of a larger discussion, making sure that you're talking to your peers, that you're talking to those that are just one or two steps ahead of you, not necessarily all the way to the top, it can bring some perspective in. And that can be really important. When I talk to younger women in science, what I usually say is, look, you need to know this. You need to understand what the playing field is out there because it's not equal. And if you don't know this, you're going to get hit really hard by something at some point. You're not going to know how to deal with it.
But once you know this and make sure you get what you can in terms of support, forget it as much as you can for a while and do what you need to do, because that's really going to get you to a position where you can make changes, where you can be the one who's saying, here's how I'm going to hire, or here's how I'm going to run things. And then when you get to that point, do what you can to make things better.
Fantastic.
So one of the things when you were showing the slides, Diana, that struck me was the letters of recommendation and the strong words that were there for men and then the words for women. But in one way you're thinking, okay, well, when I write a letter for a woman, what am I going to write? The problem is that if you write those words for women, dominant, aggressive, etc., it will actually hurt the woman. So it is that tightrope. It's a very interesting thing. You do have to learn how to be both forceful in one way, but on the other hand, not have a backlash against you. And it isn't that easy. So I think understanding it, we had someone come out and show us the data that she had done, and it's like, well, what do I do? Mm-hmm. So finding that balance is really hard, and I think finding women who are in leadership positions, or even men in leadership positions as well, who are supportive, is important in terms of negotiating any situation, and then getting there. Because if you turn everyone off, I mean, I was in one panel once where they said, well, what happens if they don't like you, or your boss doesn't like you? Well, somebody has to like you, unfortunately. You have to be likable to a certain extent to get ahead. So you have to work on some of those skills, even though they may be different than what you're really, I'm naturally aggressive, I think. But you have to learn to be somewhat in your own position if you're with someone senior or whatever.
Julie.
So I agree with both of your points. I think doing a good job always helps. I mean, being really good at what you do and trying to do the job well, and if you make a mistake, owning it and trying to find out how you do better, that's important. But then also try to understand what the people around you are assuming about you, not to challenge them, so that you could maybe subtly correct the assumption. An example would be, there was an assumption I didn't want to travel because I had children. And it was never like, I'm not giving you this because you don't want, it was just, well, you don't want to travel because you know you have young children at home. And I said, no, actually I would like to, I'm fine traveling. I can work it out, don't worry. Oh, okay. And it wasn't that I'm not giving that to you, but the assumption was I don't want to travel. So finding out what are the assumptions that are being made about you particularly. I mean, yes, it'd be great to solve the world's problems, but you kind of have to solve your own. And find, and in a subtle, nice way, correct the assumption so that, you know, oh no, I can travel. Oh no, I can work the weekends. No, I can do this. I'm willing to do this. And that helps at least. I mean, it doesn't solve everything, but I think those kinds of things can help. But yeah, and I agree with you about the, I just read those list of words and I'm like, I've heard those words, but they were not said in a nice way to me. You know, you're aggressive. You need to tone it down is what I heard, you know? So, and at the end of the day, you have to tone it down because you know, you want people to like you. You're not getting anywhere without people liking you.
I think if you're a young person, junior faculty, get yourselves a mentor. Mm-hmm. And mentors mean different things. And taken at one end, it's what I call active mentorship in other circles. It's called a sponsor. And there are different types of mentors. So obviously, you want your content expert mentor. So if you're in physics, you want make sure your grants are written properly, to read your grants endlessly, read your manuscripts. But there's also at least three other types of mentors, one of whom it would be someone who's in the hierarchy who actually has decision-making power. Mm-hmm. And yes, someone's going to, some people will like you. I mean, you're absolutely right. But there are junior faculty who go in and go, oh my God, and then slash and burn. And so now 90% of the people say, I'm not going to touch her, she's trouble. And then they become so bothered that they're just paralyzed and can't do their own work, which means that's wrong. You have to do your own work. You have to at some point just put your head down and not just equal to men. We've all found, I think, we had to be 100 times better in our work than the next man. And then just shut up and do your work and talk to your mentors. If you feel bad, never, never say it to the person who's obviously not out for you.
Good. Thank you.
So I thinking, do I have anything to add? So the only thing I would tell you is that you got to find out. So I don't think most men that I know are Neanderthals with their knuckle scraping. And I told you I would use Neanderthal.
I didn't say I'd go on with that.
So I think they just don't know, right? So they have this unconscious bias. So you got to find a way to be able to have a discussion with someone, and you got to practice it.
Yes.
You got to practice it with your friends, people, with colleagues, and say, you know, do you think that I don't want to travel? I mean, if you want to approach it, you were talking about this opportunity, and you weren't looking at me. Do you think I don't want to travel because I have young children? And not be accusatory and not be angry about it, but just ask the question. I guarantee, first, you're going to make us uncomfortable. We're going to give you whatever you want. Okay? Most guys, and I have to tell you, most men have a very difficult time having honest, open conversation with women about their biases. And so I think if you can figure out a way to do it, I think you have the upper hand. Diana, I will tell you, I loved all your slides and all the data, except one thing you said was bad, was the Google ads being given to men about three times as much to offer them $200,000 jobs. I think the reason is they know the women won't believe them. I think the men are much more gullible to sign up for the $200,000 job. So I think that's the only explanation I have for it.
There you go.
Can I ask one more point? When you're talking about mentors, too, there have been two in my life at very different points that I can think of, and neither one were sort of the one that had direct control over my career. In fact, I sometimes had to change it because I was also told that I never did get through to that person. I had to change. But the thing that I loved about both of these mentors is what they told me was, you need to get out there. You need to be strong. You need to do it. And sometimes you just need to hear that. You need to have someone. It's like my own instincts were to do this, but I'm tamping it back. How do I say it nicely? How do I be, play the female, rest of like that? And these two individuals, I think their gender bias was much more minimal because they were just talking to me at the same way they would a guy. And they're just like, quit your whining, get out there and do it. And I can't tell you how empowering that was. I needed to hear that, and it really, really helped. So if you're thinking about mentoring too, sometimes go do it. And it just resonates very, very strongly.
I think that's very, very wise advice.
Well, I was gonna say, you're exactly right. I mean, you see so many, I've seen a number of women that think they're waiting for people to call them up and be part of a panel or something. Organize the panel. People are dying. I'm a president of an organization right now. You're dying to have people come to you with ideas and wanting to do things. So, but you don't always know that when you're a junior. You're thinking, oh, I'm too intimidated to do that, and I'm going to wait until somebody. So that if you're not in the group, you have to create that. And I think that's great advice.
Well, and I think this is one example of exactly doing that, right?
Yeah.
Just a simple question in organizing something. What I'd like all of our panelists to do now is just, maybe a relatively quick sound bite in terms of what piece, I just did your heart rates all go up. What piece of advice would you like to leave the audience with in terms of, and this is going back to your goal, okay? Really, what one action item do you want to put out there for everybody in this room to then trickle out to everybody else that you work with, right? In terms of what can we do now, one thing that you want, you're going to challenge people to do now to help work against the bias in science and medicine.
All right, well, I would say, to me, community is the way to go. And this is the beginning of a community. But you all have communities in your own organizations. The faculty, the Committee on Women, the Women's Center. These are huge, huge points where you can really exert leverage and power when you do it as a group. So I would say join that group, be part of it, and contribute to it, because that is how we'll make a difference in the policies. In Faculty Senate, for example, there's a committee on women there. Often the committee doesn't do anything. Mm-hmm. And so please join your group
and let's all group together and make things change in Cleveland and Northern Ohio and Ohio, which is not looked upon as the most progressive state for women. And we'd like to change that, so we're very attractive to women scientists and entrepreneurs.
Fantastic.
So I will echo what you said, and then I have two things. One is for those of you in a position to make changes, go out and find something that's working somewhere else. There are some great examples. It's something that I'm doing right now myself, is to look at, there's a couple of physics departments and a computer science department where they've had huge changes in the number of undergraduates. What are they doing right? How can we replicate it? What can we learn from that? So that's one thing I'd encourage everyone to do. And if you're more at your own point in your career where you're trying to figure out how you maneuver forward, the one, and this sounds really stupid, it's a little bit of practical advice, but it can help reveal not your own biases, but the things that you're allowing to bias your own decision-making. Write it down. Take a list of pros and cons. I actually did this at different points in my career, and here are the reasons why I should give up and go home. Here are the reasons why I should stay. And when you look at that, and all the reasons I should give up and go home were, well, I'm not sure I'm good enough, what if they don't like me, all these other things. And the reasons for staying, I love this, this is important, I ought to be doing it. It's a really easy decision at that point. You stay in, you keep going, and if it's a confidence issue, don't let that stop you.
So, well, I don't want to echo exactly what they said, but I agree completely. And I think I read somewhere that women sometimes, when they look for jobs, if they don't hit 80% or more of the qualifications, they don't apply themselves. Yeah. Whereas I read somewhere that men, if they hit 20%, figure they can just do it. And so maybe you don't have to be 20%, but don't cut yourself out first. You know, don't be the first line and stop and say, well, I can't do it. You know, I only have three of these experiences. Just remember, there's a guy out there who has, like, one of them, who has applied and thinks he's the best. And maybe you won't get the job, but who cares? But you know what? You tried, and you might get your dream job, or you might get your dream position. And if you ask for more responsibilities, the worst they're going to say is you're not ready yet. But then you can say, well, how do I get ready? Exactly. You know, if you're not getting what you want, maybe you do need to work on A, B, C, D, and you know, you need to get this experience or that experience. How can I get that experience? Don't be afraid to ask. And then, of course, do it and do it really well, which is, you know, important.
So my little soundbite is include the men.
Yes.
Because there are a lot of women's groups, and powerful as we are together, we are. But if we just talk and gossip amongst ourselves, the men don't know. And the same types of organizational research that we heard Diana give, research has shown that men will look at themselves, even though surrounded in a gender bias place, will say, there's no gender bias. So include the men and share facts just like this.
So I'm smiling because I'm thinking of an employee who has applied for 34 positions, has zero qualifications for all of them, happens to be a guy. So I'm not kidding. It's become funny to see his name on one of the lists that he's applied again, right? So I've actually had somebody go talk to him and go, look, you gotta stop. We're just saying no before we even look. So I will tell you this. So I think, Cynthia, you know, I have three daughters. Yeah. And all of them are, you know, between the ages of 20 and 24. And what I tell them, which is, you know, I don't know if I'm wired differently or because they are women, they're wired differently than I am. They like to talk about what's happened. They like to talk about the past. They like to talk about, this is what happened today, this is why the person was wrong, all of those different things. And they tend to spend a lot of time on that. And I understand the catharsis of talking to somebody about it and having somebody understand and validate and talk about all of these things. And there's a point in time when I say to them, you gotta stop. Let's talk about the future. Let's talk about, based on what you know, what you're going to do about it. Because, you know, as Evelyn said, whining isn't enough. You got to do something. You got to get out there and just do it. So I would say is take your time, but you got to look at fixing something. You got to look at what the problem is and dealing with it instead of saying, all right, this is terrible and I shouldn't, it shouldn't have happened. Okay, that's great. Now what?
Fantastic. Thank you so much. What I want to do now is I want to open it up to the audience for some questions here. I know Shira's got a microphone back there. And if you've heard anything today, it's don't be shy and own your power and use your voice. So please, folks, if there are questions.
Hi, I'm Shanina, and I'm a PhD student here at Case. And you mentioned women have a hard time speaking up for themselves. And this is for the women panelists. I wanted to know, have you experienced this, which I'm sure, in a male-dominated environment, and how did you react to it?
I missed the first part of the question, experience.
You mentioned that women have a hard time speaking up for themselves, and I'm asking, from your experience in male-dominated environments, how did you overcome this experience? Did you win?
Well,
not that it's a competition.
Well, but I think you're asking, how do you get your voice heard?
Yeah.
And it's actually really tricky because I think probably all of us have experienced not having our voices heard. And what was really eye-opening to me were a couple of times where when I moved to a setting where the fact that I was had a PhD trumped the fact that I was female, all of a sudden people were listening to me. And I can't tell you the difference in how you react and respond when you say something and people repeat it and they're nodding, stuff like that, versus saying something and saying it again and saying it till somebody else says it a slightly different way. So I'm not sure I've got the answer in terms of how you overcome it. I think do your homework, speak up with confidence. But I will say the best thing you can do is make sure you're speaking up as often as possible, simply because eventually you're noticed as someone who is contributing to the conversation. You've got something to say, and people will begin to look to you. And the other thing is to do it, has been mentioned here, is to get good at what you do. Mm-hmm. And you will get some benefit there. It's not an even playing field. I wish it were, but keep speaking.
If I can add, I've read some things that suggest that women should speak up first, that often we wait until others have spoken. And so speaking out first if you have an idea, not waiting, is one thing. The other thing is that another recommendation is that if you're in a group and there are other women there, pay attention and reinforce. If a woman, you can't get up and say, hey, I said that, aren't you listening to me? But someone else can say, oh, I see the point that Charisse just made. Mm-hmm. And start to get that idea across that people will pay attention, because women are, they're minimized. It's a fact. I think we've all seen it.
So to give the converse of that, so this is President Karen Holbrook, president of The Ohio State University. Barbara Snyder was the provost. So imagine, I mean, I was blessed to be at that era. Karen told me, and yes, she's on first name basis, even the undergraduates. So Karen told me, even I, as president, in the boardroom, board of trustees, they try to minimize me. So then you have to decide, is it important that I say it, or is it important that the concept I want to give? So as president, obviously, it's the concept. So she would say, I am so glad that Mr. Trustee here and Mr. Trustee B, all men, of course, are supporting me. They're echoing what I just said 10 minutes ago. And she said, well, that works.
Yeah, I think also literally sitting at the table, it sounds kind of obvious, but I've been in a lot of places where there would be seats along the edge and a seat in the middle, and sit at the table, literally, even if you think everybody is 20 years your senior and you don't belong at the table, sit at the table. Because when you're at the table, they hear you, and if you're at the sidelines, they don't, and it doesn't matter if, I mean, okay, maybe the CEO in the back can do that, but unless you're that person, it's try to be at the table so at least when you speak, you're seen in a position of relative power. I mean, again, it's practical, but I think it makes a difference.
Use that space.
Yeah.
Yeah, that space.
So I would actually like to hear what Akram's point of view is, because while we women have our points of view, we need to listen to this to empower us.
Exactly.
Well, I go to work so somebody would listen to me. Because nobody listens to me at home, so. honestly, because I don't have anything useful to say. So I would tell you is that practical tool, find a male ally. If you're having an issue with it, find a male ally. So I would, one of my colleagues would, when I was not the CEO, one of my women colleagues would speak about something, and if they glossed over it, I would say, hold on a second. We just need to discuss this. I don't know if it's a good idea or a bad idea, but let's have a discussion about it. And I have to tell you, it's amazing to me. We talk about male pattern hearing. They want to hear what they want to hear. Honest to goodness, when we began these discussions and we said, let's just talk about it, it flourishes into a really wonderful conversation, because it comes from a viewpoint sometimes that no one has ever considered. So I would say to you, from a practical approach, find somebody who shares your points of view and is willing and courageous enough to say, hold on, I want to stop the conversation. I just want to talk about what she said.
Fantastic. I think one more question and then please.
I was just thinking about Diana's slides, and probably everyone else is like, I'm shocked. I'm shocked, but I'm not shocked. It's so blatantly, I kind of knew it, but I was grateful that she shared that with all of us. But something that I was thinking about is that I have a 17-year-old son, and I was telling Lynn, he's thinking about coming here, and I'm thinking to myself, have I done enough? Like, if you're talking about making a change, have I done enough to share with him that this is real? He might say, well, Mom, you can do whatever you want. You've got a good job. You know, my daughter's going to college. She's have all the opportunities. But I just think that I want to be able to share this with him and make that change from a kind of a grassroots type place. But maybe you have a book or something that any of you would think of or could recommend that I could start from, because I don't have Diana's slide deck.
have him take the implicit association test himself. The implicit association test, I think it's called the implicit bias test now.
Okay.
It's Harvard University, you can find it.
Yep.
Have him take it himself, and he will find out, because especially at 17 years old, believe me, they're biased.
I'm sure of that. I live with him.
There are two things I can tell you about 17-year-old boys when I was... We smell and we're biased. That's about it. So.
And you eat a lot.
Yeah. I still do. But have him do that and see if he's comfortable enough to talk to you about it and say to him, you know, this is life. This is what it looks like.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Wonderful advice.
I wanted to say one point that we really haven't addressed in this, and that is that women of color face additional biases in addition to this. Joan Williams has a very interesting article and has done a study in which she has shown that women who are African-American or Latina actually face additional biases in terms of their place. I think we've all had the opportunity here. I know I remember it fondly of having my postdoc be treated as if he were the PI of my grant and so forth. But they've actually, in her study, she found that women of color actually were confused with administration staff or janitorial staff even. So what she talks about is that there's a fifth area of bias that's even more so. So I think it's something that we need to be conscious of and think about. I know the Center for Women here has been trying to address some of those issues with a clever.
Last point here.
When Alice Huang was here giving the Bernadine Healy Memorial Lecture, she actually showed research, which was shocking to me, that it's actually Asian women who are the most biased group, more biased than African-American women or Latinas.
Yes.
And that's shocking. I think this may or may not be reflected in the All Case Western survey, and I think there is a group that's coming up. I sit on the advisory board, so we're going to see at the bottom of that.
Right, yeah. Joan Williams does find that it's a different kind of a bias that occurs, but it's definitely exists. in comparison to white women. So,
and I think that's something that we need to mm-hmm. be very mindful
yeah.
of. I would like you all to join me in a round of applause for these amazing panelists.